Spirit. Amen. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Saint Teresa. Saint John of the Cross. Okay, so just to let you know where we are, we spent the last 2 weeks looking at what prayer is and why we speak about prayer as we do, and I tried to situate the whole discussion in the person of Jesus Christ, because the reason that we pray is obviously because it's part of the way in which we follow our Lord. We've been given, as St. Teresa of Avila tells us, that great capacity to talk to God. Or she would put it more wonderfully, we might look at this tonight, we're given the possibility of being a friend of God. And with that said, that determines, for those who believe, it should determine everything that life is about. If you can be a friend of God, what else is there that we could possibly want other than to be a friend of God, to be a friend of Jesus Christ? Because underlying what it is to be a human being is the extraordinary possibility of relationship with others, and that means the possibility of being a friend. Okay? Even children, 4 or 5 year olds, want to be friends. It is the most remarkable human possibility that I can be somebody's friend. And that's the desire of everybody. There's no one around, unless they've got problems, who would say, I don't want to have any friends, nor do I want to be anybody's friend. Because friendship is the way that we learn to love, and is that by means that we become fully human beings. No man is an island to himself. Who said that? Some Englishman said that. And it means that we, in fact, achieve our human fulfillment and achieve our possible reality through being in relationship with another person, which is why nothing gives more joy than a relationship and nothing gives more sadness than a relationship gone wrong. And relationships gone wrong can so upset someone and hurt someone that they don't dare be in a relationship again. And when you stop to think about it, anything which can be so hurtful and harmful tells you not what you should avoid, but tells you what's at the core of what it is to be human. And when relationship goes wrong, then everything can fall apart. But when relationship works, you've got something quite wonderful. And that, as we looked at it in the last 2 weeks, is at the core of what prayer is. Because for us, prayer and what human life is about is grounded in and coloured by. We are taught how to be human through our Lord's relationship with his Father. And in that, through his relationship with other people. So I want to move on now, because I've been reminded by a few people, you meant to be talking about how to pray tonight. And if the truth be known, as you will learn, the bishop doesn't know very much about how to pray. I've been trying to do it for 30-something years, and I'm far from being an expert. Nevertheless, having been trying to do it for 30-something years, I'll talk to you about it. I want to begin by giving you the 3 classic kind of steps or forms of prayer. And I call them steps because these are things which you are called to, and as you will see this evening, we move from one form of prayer, from one way of praying to another, to another. And fundamentally, there are 3. The first is, and its classic name is vocal prayer. That's a very simple word. Vocal prayer means prayers that we say. And if you were like me, the first prayer that you were taught was probably what your mother taught you. My mother taught me from about the age of 2.5 to say the Hail Mary and the Our Father. And I have not failed to say for the whole of my life since I was taught to at least one Hail Mary and one Our Father every day. Both of the prayers that you say. And yet, you know, hands up anyone here who says prayers, hands up. But I was just checking, he's about the maximum of his hand up on the prayers that you say, it's part of ordinary prayer, like we all say prayers. We have to look at them, because that's the simplest form of prayer, the most common form of prayer. But it in fact is that part of prayer that we take for granted and in fact don't know how to do. The second form of prayer classically is what's called meditation. And I think many of you would meditate. That has nothing to do with Buddhism. It has something to do with the way that you use your mind to engage with the love of God. And we'll talk about that as a method of prayer. And there's a Filipino who's just coming back, and as I said to him yesterday, Filipinos are always late. Just said there, it's just come in. Shaking his head, but it is a Filipino. And the third form of prayer is what we call contemplation. And I will say here and now that very few of you will be contemplatives. I don't know whether I am. I don't know whether I got the prayer contemplation either. If people would say the discourse Carmelites are meant to be the experts at it, and yet being from a contemplative order, I would say, I don't know whether I do, but we'll talk about that later on. Because in fact, contemplation is what is in fact very rare. Even though today people say, I contemplate. I listen to what they say, I don't want to disappoint them, I don't say to them, you don't contemplate, but I help them grow in their prayer. Because whether they know that they don't contemplate doesn't really matter, so long as they learn how to improve their prayer. But the three classic ways of praying are, vocal prayer, meditation, and contemplation. One's left out that I'll talk about at this stage as well, and that's what you will call communal prayer. Prayer which is done with others. Okay? The Mass is the classic communal prayer. Okay? And priests are not encouraged, even though your bishop sometimes does, because he can't otherwise get to Mass. But we're not encouraged to say a Mass alone, because Mass is a community event. There needs to be other people there, as are other prayers. Like people say the Rosary together, that becomes a communal prayer. People have prayer meetings and prayer groups that are communal prayers. But generally, on one level, they're partly vocal. But the wonderful thing about communal prayer is they should make a community. That's why we call them communal prayers. And people don't, you don't come to communal prayer as an individual, but you come as an individual and lose yourself in the community. That's another matter altogether, which we might talk about another time, which is what's the value of and how does communal prayer work. But just to say something which is helpful for you, when no other prayer seems to be working for you, then you must go to because your very presence in a communal prayer may be the only thing you can do by way of prayer. But because the value of it is within the context of community, you are doing something valuable. You know, I don't know whether I do anything worthwhile as your bishop, but I do know that if I say Mass for you as your bishop, I'm doing something worthwhile that God thinks is good. And maybe it's the only thing I can do each day which is of any value at all, I don't know. But I do know and believe that when I participate in, especially when as a bishop I lead community prayer, I know it's of value in itself because for God it is valuable. And in being part of that, I am part of this which is valuable. That's enough for communal prayer because I'm here talking to you about prayer. Let's turn to vocal prayer. And you know, the classic example of that is when you pray like this, and what did Jesus pray? Our Father, in heaven, may your name be held holy. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And do not put us to the test. That's a vocal prayer, and we need to look at that. I won't have time, because this is already the third talk of five, to spend time with you talking about the Our Father. But the Our Father is the classic vocal prayer. It's a prayer that we say. Another prayer that is a vocal prayer is the Hail Mary and the Rosary. But the Hail Mary and the Rosary in its own way falls into insignificance compared to the Our Father. Why? Pretty obvious the answer is, because whatever the Our Father is, Jesus prayed. Okay. And so when you think about vocal prayers, there are two kinds. There are those vocal prayers that you've learned to say. And which of these, in my opinion, are more valuable and significant? The significance of the prayer is determined by the people who pray. What makes this cathedral a holy place? The people who pray in this cathedral. What makes a pilgrimage site a sacred place? The people who've gone there and what's happened there. Okay? Otherwise I could say, well, I'm going to turn my backyard into a sacred space. That's bizarre. What's so holy about my backyard? Except sometimes Michael helps mow the lawn there, and I go out there sometimes, and that doesn't make it holy, nor does it make it a sacred place. Sacred places are sacred because people go there and do holy things. And as the years go on, the holiness in fact collects around that place. What makes a prayer holy is the people who pray it. So there are certain prayers which are holy prayers, and yet that doesn't yet tell you how to pray them. Because otherwise, the prayers which are vocal prayers are simply words. And I want to begin in looking at vocal prayer to teach you how to pray prayers. You remember what our Lord tells us in St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, which is what I spoke to you about last on the first evening. In your prayers, this is Matthew 6, verse 7, in your prayers do not babble as the pagans do, for they think that by using many words they will make themselves heard. Do not be like them. That's why, for example, it's not that it's wrong, I can never say the rosary with other people. Because most Catholics are so fast, I just simply get annoyed. No, I'm out of here. I'm not going to be part of this because I know that if I say those words like that, I know for sure I am not praying. You know what I'm talking about? Huh? So the words themselves are not significant. And yet, on the other hand, they may. Why is the Hail Mary significant? Because we're repeating the words of the angel. Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you. You are most blessed. That's why the Hail Mary. Have you ever thought about it? Do not say prayers without thinking about what you're saying. If you have an appointment to come and see me as your bishop, would you think about what you're going to talk about or just walk in and talk about your shoes? Yeah? You're laughing because it is bizarrely silly to think that you would make an appointment to come and talk to me and talk about the colour of your socks. Okay? I don't wear socks, so I wouldn't know what you're talking about. But we use words when we speak to each other and we think about what those words are. And how often do we pray prayers to God and we don't even think about what we're saying and they become a babble of words. The first thing I want to say about praying words is do not pray like that. because it would be like coming and talking to the bishop about when you last washed your socks. And I would think, what on earth is Michael talking about, coming and talking to me about his socks? And you must think to yourself, when you use vocal prayers, you are talking to God. And the first thing I want to say to you when you pray words is, you must know what you're saying. Because if you don't know what you're saying, you are babbling many words. And if you think that saying these many words in their own way is somehow holy, or going to do something, let me tell you, it might be in a way good, but it is a poor second compared to you saying these words as a way of talking to God and in knowing what you're saying, meaning what you're saying. Because when you go out, look at the young ones in front of you, for the first time with your first boyfriend, or with your first girlfriend, Michael, and you're going to talk to them. Are you going to talk nonsense? Or are you going to mean what you say? When you pray, you're talking to the person that you love. You're not just saying prayers. That's what makes prayer become prayer. It's not a babble of words, but you're talking to someone that you love. And the first thing is, you have to know what you're saying. And you have to mean what you're saying. Otherwise, put yourself in Jesus' position. What on earth is Father being talking about? I died on the cross for him, and he comes and sits there and babbles words. And he hasn't bothered to think about it. He does, he's a good prayer, but I'm using him as an example. He hasn't bothered to think about why he's using these words. And more importantly, he's not putting any love into the words that he's saying. Because vocal prayer opens up a great possibility in praying. Only if you pray the words properly. So what do you need to do when you sit down at home or in church or kneel down before the Blessed Sacrament and you think, I'm going to say the Our Father? Well, you better think about the words you're saying. Why? Because when you talk to God, the words that you use if you are praying are the ways that you express to God how much you love Him. Otherwise, all you're doing is saying words. Now, you might say, but Bishop, that's how I prayed for the last 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. And I'll say, that's okay, you can change tonight. And so the first step in vocal prayer, the prayers that you pray become what St. Teresa of Avila would say, real prayer, prayer from the heart, prayer of love, when those words in fact are what you mean to say to God. When those words begin to be words of love. And she says, when the words that you say become prayers of love, and I'm going to use the word which we Carmelites use, and if you don't like it, write to the Pope and we'll find you another bishop. But you're stuck with a Carmelite, I can't help it. That's what I am. I've been a Carmelite since 1985, that's 33 years now, and I'm too old to change it. The Saint Teresa says, prayer becomes pleasing to God when she calls it mental prayer. I don't know why she calls it that. It's not mental as in man. But it's prayer that now comes from who you are. You're not walking in and saying, what am I going to say to the bishop? Well, when I get in there, I'll say the divine chaplet. And I'll think, why on earth are you saying that to me? Be careful that you're not saying prayers simply because someone said it's a good thing to say. Because prayer without love is not very good prayer. And we have to find a way to turn our words into, St. Teresa of Lisieux would say, words which open the heart to call out to God. Isn't that wonderful? But that's kind of the way she puts it. It's an aspiration of the heart. Okay? And it means that if you pray with words, your word has to be a word which makes your heart cry out to God. Okay? And think about it, those of you who have got children. When your children talk to you, your heart cries out and goes to them because you love them. And if your words express your love to God, what's God's response going to be to you? God's movement of love to you. Because God cannot help himself but to love you and return to you in love. So let's look at the words. Let's look at the Our Father. Because St. Cyprian wrote a book on the Our Father. St. Augustine writes a whole lot of things on the Our Father. St. Teresa writes from about the way of perfection, that could be from about chapter 29 all the way through to about chapter 40. About 11, 12 chapters on the words of the Our Father. Because she said, when you pray the Our Father, pray the words with love. And then you will find that you will slowly begin to learn how to pray. Now you all pray the Our Father, I know that. Now I've got to begin to teach you what it means to pray. Let's turn to the first words of the Our Father, because I want to help you turn your words, your vocal prayer, into wonderful prayer. Now remember, what are the words of the Our Father there? Given to us by Jesus in verse 9 and following, verse 10, verse 9 and following of chapter 6 of St. Matthew's Gospel. And let's get back to where these words are coming from. Why is Jesus teaching the apostles the words of the Our Father? Because in St. Luke's Gospel, the disciples come to him at a moment when he's alone praying in their midst and say to him, Lord, teach us to pray. He says, when you pray, pray like this. But in fact, in Luke's Gospel, he says, pray these words. But what's Jesus doing when he gives the Our Father? He's answering the question of the disciples, which goes like this, what are you doing when you're praying? Because you're there alone praying. And to let you know why it was so attractive for them and raised so many questions, St. Augustine, one of the greatest saints in the Catholic Church, saw St. Ambrose praying, or not praying, reading the Gospel. And he said, this man is a holy man. You know why he said he was a holy man? Because he was reading the Gospel without moving his lips. And I can do that. It's about the only holy thing that I can do. I can read the Gospel without moving my lips. Because in the time of St. Augustine, 5th century, for someone to read something without saying the words was amazing, because everybody said the words. So to see somebody reading without saying words, fascinating. Whatever Jesus did when he prayed, fascinated the disciples. And they said, what are you doing? And he said, what I'm doing is this. And he gave us the Our Father. The Our Father, I believe, is more than a prayer which we give to you to say, but it's a prayer which tells us something about Jesus' own prayer, about his relationship to his own Father. So what's the value for you? What's the value for St. Teresa? If I can pray these words correctly, and we need to look at what that means to begin to move on to meditation and other things. If I can pray these words correctly, maybe I will say them the way Jesus. Maybe I would begin to have a relationship with God which is the same as Jesus' relationship with God the Father. I don't know what you want. Your bishop, unfortunately, is a Carmelite, and it's what I want. I want to have a relationship with God the Father which is the same as Jesus, because no other relationship is good enough for me. Because no other relationship with God the Father is real. Because he came into the world to show me how to be in a loving relationship with God. That's what he came to teach me. So let's go to the Our Father. So the obvious thing is the word Father, when you look at it. Have you ever stopped to think about it? And let me tell you what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean your Father and your relationship with your Father. But if you're like me, my dad was a wonderful man. And you hear me talking about him in my homilies and in my talks. And you hear me talking about my mum as well. I'm a very blessed man, but I know that not everyone has the same experience of their mum or their dad. And when Jesus says, our Father, he doesn't mean your Father. It's the first thing to say. So the thing that you have to get in mind when you say, our Father, you have to try to mean what Jesus said when he said, our Father. And I've told you what Jesus means by that, which is why I can talk about it tonight. I told you about that 2 Mondays ago. Can you remember? Can anyone remember what I said 2 Mondays ago? I'm going to turn around and see if some of you know who's here. Don't see, can't see anyone who wants to answer. Oh, your point here is, were you here, Gregory? Well, what did I say 2 Mondays ago about the Father? That means next year I can give all these talks again and you won't know. Yes. Our Father, the Jesus, is the one who sent the baptism. You are my beloved Son. It's the first time really strongly in the Gospel the word Father comes up. Any other place that comes up is St. Luke's Gospel. You do not know that I must go about my Father's business. But that was probably added later on. In terms of the foundational part of the Gospel, the word Father comes up in Jesus saying, you're my Son, which means I am your Father. And the word beloved means there is no one that I love more than you. I told you that 2 Mondays in a row. This is the 3rd Monday, so please don't forget. Who's the Father for Jesus? The one who says, there is no one that I in the world that I love more than you, and I love you more than I love myself. And if you don't know this, when I do the Good Friday service, I'm kicking you out of my cathedral in the morning. Because Jesus' answer is, and I love you, Father, more than I love my own life. You are my beloved. You are my Father. You are the one that I love more than I love myself, even more than my own life. And if you don't know that, you'll never understand Good Friday. Because you will think just about obedience, just about saving you, and you won't have any sense that it's really about love. And about how much Jesus loved his Father, and who Jesus was, because Jesus is the one loved by his Father. So when he says, when you pray, pray like this, our Father, it means that when you say those words, you're talking to someone who loves you more than anybody else in the world. What a wonderful way to begin to pray. Our Father. Father, I know you love me. Who am I? I am the one loved by you. Who are you, our Father in heaven? There is no one greater than you, which means I'm everything. You know, there's no one in the world greater than me. There's no one in the world greater than you. Because the Father says, I'm your Father. And I love you so much And when you begin praying, dear Father, you begin by growing in the knowledge of who you are because of who God is and how God loves you. You know, Saint Therese could never finish the rosary. You think, was she lazy? Saint Therese of Avila, I think the greatest woman saint in the world after Mary, the mother of Jesus, because she's a woman saint. The next greatest woman saint, I think, is Saint Therese of Avila. And she said, I could never finish an Our Father. I would go to pray for an hour, she said, and I couldn't ever finish the Our Father. Forget about anything else. Because she would say the word Father, and she would spend an hour with God, her Father. And she couldn't take her heart away from God. And what happened? Those words, which are called vocal prayer, caused her to love God. That's why we say prayers. And when that happens, vocal prayer becomes something more fun, more wonderful than prayers just said. Can you see what I'm saying? That's what a Carmelite tries to do when they say prayers. It doesn't always work. Because prayer, as we'll see next week, will have its ups and downs. But that's what I want you to begin to do, is to learn how to say the prayers that you've been saying the whole of your life. Because those words, if you say prayers, are the way that you try to tell God that you love God. And through them, if they're said properly, you will experience God's love for you. And in that, you'll come to know who God is and grow. That's the first level of prayer. That's called vocal prayer. And I don't have to tell you how to say prayers, because you've all done it all your life. But at this first stage, I'm teaching you how to pray. Just trying to give you hints on how to say the prayers that you've always said. What's that mean? It means, and these vocal prayers can't be said to somebody else. You can't go, because you have to sit there and learn to talk to God. And that's pretty hard. You just have to sit there and we'll look at more of this morning with the difficulties in prayer next week. But you have to find time and a bit of space each day to talk to God. And you begin by saying, I'm setting aside some time and space for you, what can I do? But at this stage, I'll try saying these prayers. Now the question comes out, and how are you going to say them? With love. And you might say to me, but Bishop, at this stage I don't know how to love God. And I wouldn't be surprised if many of you would say to me, I don't know how to love God. Fine. That's okay. We'll get to that. Then try to mean the words that you say with all your heart and put effort into it. Let's turn very quickly to meditation, because I'd hope to have this, what I've just said, finished by 7:15, and now it's 8:22. I'm a failure. It's right this way, Father Jim. It's dreadful, but anyway, you have to put up with it. Stuck. Meditation. What's meditation? People speak about meditation. People think it's sit down, relax, put your hands on your chair, breathe in, breathe out. I can't do that, because within 5 minutes I start falling asleep. I don't know what you do when you try to do that, but it always leads me to start to yawn, to doze off. No. Meditation, in the classic sense, in the Christian sense of the word, is not the same as transcendental Buddhist meditation. And there's something good in that. We might look at that later on. But what people do when they meditate, they often meditate on something. And the good people visit the Jesuits. But let me tell you what happens. You pick up the gospel and you read something and you meditate on the words of that passage. You have, as Saint Teresa did, a statue. And you look at the statue and you meditate on the meaning of the statue. You have something which might have been from the Gospels, but maybe the Psalms, because I haven't looked at things in vocal prayer, which I should go back to. I could have given a whole talk on vocal prayer. I didn't know there was so much to say until I started talking, but anyway. What we do when we meditate is we identify that when we want to pray, the thing which takes us away from prayer so often is what? It's your thinking, your brain. And your brain goes all over the place. When you meditate, you turn your mind to something. Something about God. Something which will move you to love God. And then you try to quieten yourself so that your heart now turns to God. Now, to do that, you use your mind. You think about, as you will do in Holy Week, if you read the Agony in the Garden, you'll think about what happened to Jesus. You'll think about his worry. You'll think about the passion. And you'll think about the pain of what he went through for love of you. Then you'll think about things like, and it was because of me and his love of me that he went through all of that. And then you'll think in terms of how grateful you are for him. And you'll feel bad in yourself that it was partly because of you that he died on the cross. And in the mixture of your sense of remorse for your own sins, your sense of sadness for what he suffered, and your gratitude to him for suffering this for me, he would have done it just for me. And then you allow yourself to come to a place of quiet, just to sit in the garden with him next to him, looking into his eyes and being with him, trying to comfort him, to feel what he felt, so as to be with him, so as to love him. That's meditation. And what we do for that is an image will help us. We can look at our Lord on the pillar being scourged, that's what St. Teresa used to do. We can think about things, and that's what we do in the rosary. The point of the rosary is not the prayers that we say, but so that we will be at one with Jesus through his Mother Mary. In fact, it's a meditative prayer. Okay? Whether you finish the words or not, doesn't matter. Because so many Carmelites can never finish the words, because the words and the thinking lead to a movement of the heart, so that the heart and the mind and the soul come together. And as it then becomes, in the space of being one with Jesus, a simple loving movement of the heart. And that very simply, because I have to hurry up, I'm running out of time, is at the core of what meditation is. And it's a good thing to do. Some people can do it and do it well, others can't do it. As it turns out, St. Teresa is not good at meditating. In fact, Carmelites in general are not very good at meditating. Okay, we tend to find that difficult. But you might find it helpful. And so long as doing that will help you move to love God, keep doing it. The thing about prayer is you don't look for something different to do today. You learn to do something which works and you keep doing it until it doesn't work. Because as you learn to pray, something's happening in you. Because as you learn to pray and do pray, God's love starts to enter your soul through your prayer. And that begins to change you. I've got to go back to vocal prayers. I wanted to say something important because I think to myself, I don't have to do any of my talks perfectly because I'll be back doing these talks next year, the year after that, and the year after that, as long as you remember what I've said. But I won't let you very quickly forget what I say anyway, so it'll take time for all of this to go in. So I want to go back to something about vocal prayer. What makes a prayer whole? You might say the person who wrote it. I will say even more the impact that these prayers have had on people in such a way that these prayers have helped them become holy. That makes sense, doesn't it?
You know, which prayer should you pray? People come to me, you know, Bishop, what prayer should I pray? Well, I need to learn about you to have a sense of what prayer will work. But it has to be one that I know is made up of your whole. And of all the prayers, there's one book of prayers which is so holy that this book of prayers is part of the Bible. And I know many people who pray those prayers. St. Joseph prayed, Mary, our mother, prayed, Jesus prayed, the Gospel tells us he did. St. Peter prayed, Mary MacKillop prayed. Every saint that you see with the statue in this room prayed. I prayed, and that doesn't really matter what I pray. The Pope prays. I praise them every day, and they're the Psalms. They're very holy prayers. We might talk about them another day, but they're holy because if Jesus, as he probably did, knew them off by heart, they're important prayers, haven't they? And they prayed them, they used to sing them together, and they used to pray them alone. You know, we've got it there that he knew them off by heart. Who taught them to it? Probably Joseph and Mary. And they were so important to him. Another one, of course, of our fathers. I'm just giving you that so you've got a sense of that when you say prayers, and in fact try to pray as I told you, if you pray a prayer and it helps you love God, then you're at one with everyone else who prayed that very prayer because it made them holy too. It's amazing just to think that you're saying today a psalm, as I did today, I sit in my office and I prayed the psalms, and I was saying prayers today that I knew Jesus prayed. And the words I was saying were words that he would have prayed them in Aramaic, but the meaning was the same. It's amazing to think when you pray, you can say the same words, just another language or so, that Jesus said. So if you're going to say prayers, they're good ones to say. Okay, let's move on. Now I want to move on to contemplation briefly. You can't choose to contemplate. There are some spirituality books that will say, yes, you know, do this, this is contemplation. I belong to an order which is a contemplative order. And let me say to you here and now, you can't choose to contemplate. Why? Because contemplation is a prayer that God gives you. Just as if you pray Gobi prayers, I suggested to you, you will find that your prayer begins to change because you're saying it with love. And if you, for example, St. Teresa promised to us, her brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, if you pray the Our Father the way I'm suggesting to you, I promise you, within a few months your prayer will be different. If you spend time slowly saying the words and meaning them with love, your prayer will change. And when that happens, the change is the prayer becomes less and less your prayer, but more and more God is part of it. See, that's what happens at the beginning of prayer. It's a lot of effort, it's a lot of work on my part. And that's what it is, for example, when you make friends with someone. There's a lot of work on your part to make friends with people. It's what's he wanting to do things for? Constantly wanting to prove to the person that you love them. You want to know whether they love you. But as your relationship, your friendship begins to grow, it becomes simpler. There's nothing much to say, just like being with each other. And you don't worry about whether that person loves you because you know that they do. They don't have to tell you that they love you because they know that you already know that they do.
And in fact, the relationship begins to take on a life of its own. It's the same with prayer. As prayer begins to grow, the life of prayer takes on a life of its own. And it becomes less and less what you do, and more what God does. And a certain point can happen in prayer when it's not you praying, but it's God praying with you. That's what St. Paul meant when he said, I don't think it means what charismatics mean, when he says, the Spirit cries out within you and prays within you. This is not crying out and speaking in tongues and things like that. I don't think it is. It's something far more profound. It's got to do with being a temple of the Holy Spirit. It's got to do with prayer and get to that point where God prays. Okay? And you can't choose to do that. You can't say, well, I'm going to sit here and wait until God prays. Because this begins to happen as your whole life becomes about prayer. It's not simply about going and praying, but it means that when you're doing things for God and it is of God. It means that all of your activity, what you do, is loving. It means that God is loving others through you. It means you become more and more a good person. And it doesn't mean that you're free of your weaknesses and your failings and your temptations, but it means that these things don't stop you loving, and that in spite of these things about yourself, you in fact get beyond so much of your failures, that in fact it's God working within you. And that when you help others and do things, it's not because of anything about you, it's not about pride. Is that you love and help others because it's God doing everything. So see, what happens if prayer is properly in place? Your life will also change. Because as I said to you on our first night, what can I say about prayer? Prayer and life are one. They're not distinct from each other. St. Teresa would say to me, if I was to say to her, Mother, tell me, I want to talk to you about my prayer, tell me about my prayer, but she would look me in the eyes and say, don't be stupid. Show me how you love other people and I will tell you what your prayer is like. But this only becomes a reality as your prayer becomes stronger and more mature. That's why the beginning part is hard, but the spin-off has to become the way you live and the kind of person you are. Because true prayer is not apart from the life you live and the kind of person you are. That's why, in all honesty, you could look at your bishop and say, you've been a Carmelite for 30-something years and you're not good at prayer yet. Because you don't love well enough yet. That's the problem. And that's why we have to work at it. And how do we begin so that by trying to be selfless and not moved by those things which disturb us? We'll look at this next week. Because you've all got your weaknesses as I do, and I have to spend the rest of my life coming to understand and know my weaknesses more and more deeply so I can spend my life trying to balance correctly. Fight against them. How do I correct them? By loving other people. Not by fighting them in myself, but by doing what Jesus did and loving others. And that becomes part of prayer, because unless this becomes firmly part of your life and becomes who you are, forget about even thinking about what contemplation is. Because contemplation is, I don't believe, begins to happen until you've grown not only in virtue, but as I was saying to the kids at Woodlawn today, in truth and goodness. Okay, let's stop and see what begins to happen. To put it another way, because I've got 5 minutes, you begin praying as you learn to pray by being active. You do a lot of work
You set aside time, and you give the time, and you struggle, and you work, and you think, I want to go and do something else, but no, I'll stay here and pray. And you spend your time trying to be good, and to fight the weaknesses, and to love others, and to be, tell you what's that, to raise it. She thought, I have to be able to love the people that I don't like. And there were people she couldn't stand in the car, and they thought they were her best friends. You know, remember that. It's not about loving the people you love. Jesus, even tax collectors and sinners do that, don't they? What virtue is that in loving those who love you? Virtue comes in caring for the people who don't like in such a way that they have no idea that they know you. You've joined the wrong religion. Being a Catholic is very difficult if you want to do it. And that's part of it. So that activity that you have to keep putting into it, to learn to pray and be a personal prayer. But as time goes on, as you come, when you first begin to pray, there's some returns for you with prayer. Beginners of prayer seem to like to pray. We Carmelites have to spend so much time praying. We have to pray. I'd do anything. St. Teresa of Avila said, no, think of all the penances and all the hard work I'd much rather than do to go and sit in that chapel for an hour. I'd much rather do penance than pray. And it could be like that. And when there's nothing left for you, you have to do all you can do to do the works of love. His prayer must move to that period where your prayer is an act of faith. It being there for God when God doesn't seem to be there. In going into prayer when nobody answers and seems dry and awful. What happens when you get married, Michael, to continue to be there for your children and your wife when there's nothing in it? When you'd much rather run away and go and do something else. To go home from work and to think. I don't feel loved at the moment, but that will happen for every man and woman. I don't feel any love for this person. Then your love now becomes an act of faith. That's what faith means. Not what you believe, but you continue because you believe. You have to do that. And how do you do that? By loving, because faith and love go together. And you do the things of love. And as you do that, which is what we call passivity, prayer becomes less active than your part. And where you can't do things, God now enters in and begins to pray in you. Without you realizing, you're in fact changing the inside. Because you can't begin to have contemplation until God in fact starts to purify you from the inside. And as that begins to happen, that third thing in prayer will begin to start to show itself. And you won't even know. There'll be these moments when, yes, it's almost like something bubbles up from deep within, and you notice something. What bubbles up is so beautiful and wonderful, and it might only be for 3 or 4 seconds. You might never experience it again, ever, or for months or years. But it's because God is now starting to pray, and then you begin to move to contemplation. There are other things we can talk about for the movement of contemplation. That's not the topic of this year's talks. So it's 8:02. I'll see if anyone has any questions. Otherwise, I have to go home and cook my dinner. Because nobody cooks for me. That's all right. It's because I probably cook better than others. I cook for myself, simply out of selfishness. Not out of anybody. It's because I don't mind my own cooking. And
Father Jim doesn't mind it either. He's sitting over there. And you notice Father Max is hiding behind the post. So any questions or comments? Stand up if you do and shout it out, otherwise I won't need it. Don't make any sense.
Here.
Yes, Father Jim.
Since you mentioned me so often, I will ask you a question. You spoke about what I call the intimacy of relationship with Jesus and his Father. While I realize there's a depth of appreciation, why did he say, my God, why have you abandoned me?
Yes, because it's part of relationship to sometimes not experience the love of the other person. And if we love simply because we experience another person's love, it means that we might have love, but we don't experience the love. What was very clear in Jesus was, even though I don't experience your love, I believe in it. I'm so certain of your love that even though it seems that you don't love me, you're not there, I will continue to love you. And this is an example of the greatest form of love. I can remember when I was in first form, that's at grade 7, and our maths teacher was a priest, and he also taught us religion. And he had this wonderful thing in Form 1. All the first formers, including your bishop, we were all members of what he called the Angel Society. We thought this was fun, and we would meet one lunchtime a week with Father Connolly and sit down and chat, because he's an amazing old fellow. And he would say, we could ask him about the faith, and he said to us, you know, he said, sometimes, he said, I wonder whether I believe in God. He said, because I have my own doubts, like you will have when you grow up, he said. But I know, and I tell myself, I believe in God even more than I know the sun's going to come up tomorrow. And he said to us, I want you all to say that. When you have doubts, to say, I know that God exists more than I know the sun's going to come up tomorrow. And that's what Jesus was saying there as he was dying. Where are you? But into your hands I commend my spirit. Because even though I've cried out for you to help me, the pain is excruciating. You're not doing anything to take away the pain. You're nowhere to be found. But I believe in your love. Never, ever doubt it. That's what was happening, which is why, you know, this is one of the most wonderful things in the gospel. The depth of Jesus' belief. That's what faith is. Faith is not, I believe in one God, the Father, Almighty. What does it mean to believe that? You're muttering it off. Do you really believe it? Do you even understand what you're saying? The real belief is belief in the love of the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. And all that that means, and that means everything that the Church teaches in fact. What's at the core of it? And that's what we have when Jesus dies. Where are you? I believe you. I'm dying. I'm going to die. And I'm in pain. There's no one to help. You can come down from the cross, though I won't. I will die. Because I believe. You know, when you think about it, it's the most extraordinary statement of his relationship with his Father anywhere. And it's that sense in which I love you more than I love myself. And so, into your hands, any other thought or question? Does that kind of answer you?
Reciting
the Jesus prayer. Can you come up closer because you're so far away from us and I'm feeling you know that I've got a broken microphone.
Just
this is
reciting the Jesus prayer.
Yes, that's a very interesting prayer. And never think that the prayer is magical. The prayer will help you love. prayer will help you take you out of yourself away from your own selfishness. The prayer will help you enter a space where you are with God. Do never think that any prayer that you use or say and pray will work for the rest of your life. I remember an old sister, I was newly ordained, and my first direct retreat, I was with three people, I won't tell you, but by one of them was a fellow that I advised to leave the seminary. And I said, he was a terrible thing to say to someone who knows nothing. He left the seminary and came back, and he was ordained, and then he left. Then there was another one, she was an old woman, a very old woman, by this stage she was about 80. And I said to her, you must stop praying the Jesus prayer. You have to just love, because what you're saying is coming between you and the love of God. So don't let what you're saying come between you. And don't be afraid to let go of what you're saying and simply be in silence. And she continued to come and see me. She was from County Offaly. Lovely Joseph. She died in Australia. She came to see me until she couldn't walk and she was 89. She kept coming out and seeing me for the next 9 years. I didn't know what I was talking about, but obviously what I said to her helped her. So the Jesus prayer can be useful, but do not hold on to it. Don't hold on to any prayer. You hold on to God. Anyone else? Okay, well I'm going to go. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, it is now, and ever shall be. Glory be to the Father, and to the Holy Spirit. Next week, the second last talk, we will talk about difficulties in prayer. Because if you try to do anything that I told you to do, you'll come up against difficulties. So